Hello, everyone. My name is Yafeng Yin. I'm a professor and interim chair of the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering at University of Michigan. So welcome to the University of Michigan Building the Future Distinguished Lecture Series. In 2019, our department finished a two-year strategic visioning process and completed our strategic vision, which include five strategic directions. They're enhancing human habitat experience, shaping resource flow, autonomy and smart infrastructure finance, and adaptation to external stressors such as climate change. So this is the focus of today's webinar. This is an exciting focus for our department and for the profession as a whole. Our strategic vision reaffirms our value proposition to our communities, reinforce our commitment as engineers working in service to society. To highlight our vision and to formulate a working plan, we launched this Building the Future Distinguished Lecture Series, so which provide a forum to discuss each strategic directions. It's aimed to build a broad community network that includes industry professionals, researchers, educators, students, through presentation from leading experts and panel discussion that provide new insights. The series really explore a range of perspectives on those five strategic directions. So we have had a lot of support to make this vision and today's presentation come together. I'd like to thank our co-sponsor of the event, Kleinfelder. I also thank the Strategic Implementation Committee led by Professor Sanyung Lee. Special thanks goes to Professor Jeremy Breaker, who is an associate professor at the University of Michigan. And Professor Breaker has agreed to serve as a moderator for today's presentation and panel discussions. A few more words on the accessibility of today's webinar. We want to make our event accessible to all participants. So this webinar will have live automated captions. A transcript will be available. To choose a viewing options, click live transcript on the control bar at the bottom of your screen, where you can show or hide the subtitle or view the future, the full transcript. I will now turn the session over to Professor Jeremy Breaker. Professor Breaker, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Yafeng. Let's welcome everyone participating in today's event. First off, the distinguished lecture emphasizes the strategic theme of adaptation. To give an overview of this theme, Michelle is going to share a video. Please go ahead, Michelle.
Adaptation is a necessary thing for survival. We're dealing with many things that are affecting our life. Climate change is essentially raising sea levels, and that's going to affect coastal communities. It will cause more severe storms, more severe hurricanes and tornadoes that are becoming increasingly frequent and increasingly destructive. We are looking at how extreme events like hurricanes and earthquakes affect communities, and how can these communities recover quickly from these different types of events. My colleague Evgeny Filipov, he is looking at how origami can help us design structures that change shape, that respond to various types of hazards as they occur. My colleague Valery Ivanov, he's looking in the Amazon at how trees interact together and how they grow within that environment. My work is focused a lot on earthquake engineering. If we do not build our structures to be resistant to earthquakes, we are going to get structures that would fail in a catastrophic manner. We will always be adapting to new stressors that will appear on the horizon. We just don't know what they are yet. Through human ingenuity, we will always be able to adapt to whatever situation exists.
Thank you, Michelle. So today, we're going to have a lecture and then a panel discussion. During the lecture, attendees, if you have questions, please submit them using the Q&A function. We have some pre-submitted questions, which we'll address first, and then we'll try to get to as many of your questions as time allows during the panel session after the lecture. So now, please let me introduce our very special speaker and panelists. We're very fortunate to have Bas Jonkman, a professor at the Delft University of Technology in the Netherlands. He will speak to us about adaptation to sea level rise. Dutch experiences and global challenges. The presentation by Bas will be followed by a panel discussion with three panelists who we're very lucky to have, Louis Armstrong, Oki Nogu, and James Smith. Louis Armstrong is the president and CEO of the firm Kleinfelder. Oki Nogu is president of Omega Hydrodynamics Research and is recently retired as a professor from the University of Michigan Department of Naval Architecture and Marine Engineering. And Jane Smith is an emeritus research scientist for the U.S. Army Engineer Research and Development Center in Mississippi, and is a member of the National Academy of Engineering. So that brings us to today's distinguished lecture. Please let me invite Bas Jonkman to speak about adaptation and give his presentation.
Thank you, Jeremy. Good evening. It's evening here in the Netherlands. It's thank you to University of Michigan for inviting me, having me. And it's also nice to see in the participant list some old colleagues and friends. My talk is about adaptation to sea level rise in the Netherlands, some investigations we did as part of the national adaptation strategies that are now being investigated. Here's the Netherlands in northwestern Europe, that small country about 200 miles north to south and about 100 miles east to west, and most of our country is prone to flooding. The dark blue areas are below sea level and the lighter blue areas are above sea level but prone to flooding from rivers. So that's about 60% of the country, but the majority of the population is living in these areas. So adapting to sea level rise is, let's say, for the Netherlands, a major national issue. In the Netherlands, there's been quite a debate and a lot of attention, and a lot of the media and documentaries focused on these quite dramatic scenes that Amsterdam at some point would be an underwater city. It would be the last generation of children who could experience the coast in the West. And even our national philosopher joined the debate, saying that this threatens the country. And he was also worried about the future of his children being able to live in the West of this country. Also, planners and architects started to add to this discussion with these long-term visions of that include giving up parts of the country, an archipelago of islands, and let's say on the right side, a lot of the population center moved to the east. But as an engineer and also others with me started to ask questions, to what extent is the adaptation of the current water management system that we have possible? What are then the engineering options and their limits and challenges for adaptation? And in this talk, I will highlight a number of those issues based on some of the previous studies I've been involved in. Here are the, let's say, sea level rise scenarios that we now mostly work with in the Netherlands on the vertical axis in meters. If you want to convert to feet, multiply it by 3. So in case the world manages to stay in a low emission scenario, sea level rise will be about 1 to 2 feet in the coming century. In case of the high emission scenario, we'll go up to 10, 12, 15 feet over the coming centuries. So these are the scenarios that we will also investigate during this presentation. Here's a quick, let's say, overview of these flood defense system. In the southwest, after the 1953 disaster, the exposed coastline has been shortened by a series of dams and storm surge barriers called the Delta Works. Particularly the Rotterdam area is protected by this storm surge barrier, the Maasland barrier, which can be closed during storm surge conditions. Along this, the upper box, the Holland coast, are fortunate to have a sandy system with very nice dunes. And in the north, there are, let's say, the Wadden intertidal area with dikes. And of course, we also have river levees. And in total, we have around 3,800 kilometers of levee, so over 2,500 miles. And on an annual basis, more than $1 billion is spent to continuously reinforce large parts of this system. So this is what we call the primary flood defenses along the rivers and the coast. Well, we have studied the various systems and on their future adaptation potential and the limits. And I think the system where the first limits will be experienced is this Eastern Scheldt system, where a storm surge barrier has been constructed with gates that are normally open to allow flow and sediment to go in and out this intertidal area, but that can be closed during the storm surge. Because of the construction of the barrier, the, let's say, sediment inputs have already been decreased, and the intertidal flats behind the barrier are already decaying. So for the future, if we look at the future, we'll see that where we have now about closure, storm closure, about once every year, in case of 1 meter, 3 feet of sea level rise, that will change up to a weekly closure. And if sea level rises a bit more with the current closure levels, it will be at around 4 feet, go to a permanent, almost permanent closure. And then basically the whole idea that you leave it partially open to allow sediment to go in and out is basically gone. Well, then there are different options, improvement or change of the barrier, partial removal of the barrier and strengthening the dikes around the estuary, or nourishment of the tidal flats, which is already partially done to preserve those tidal flats. So this is one of the first bottlenecks in the system in an already, a bit of a lost equilibrium in terms of morphodynamics. A key area where there are also a lot of discussion is this Rotterdam-Rijnmond area that's protected, basically the Rotterdam area, protected by these movable gates that are normally open. And the current strategy is that the barrier protects against the very high storm surges and also levees in the city of Rotterdam that is behind the barrier are present. In the current system, this barrier is managed by Rijkswaterstaat, the Dutch Army Corps, and there's reliability requirements, about 1 in 100 per demand required, that are for which the barrier scores at this moment just sufficient. The issue is that with sea level rise, the current closure frequency will increase. The current closure frequency is about once every 5 to 10 years for storm closures, but that will increase to 3 times per year for 1 meter of sea level rise. So 3 feet of sea level rise and almost weekly for higher sea level rise rates. That will have a number of effects. It will affect the overall reliability of the barrier because it will close more. The overall reliability will go down. It will be, some parts of it will be more heavily loaded. So fatigue, for example, to the ball joint of the barrier. So these are definitely issues. And behind the barrier, there are also a number of areas in Rotterdam that are unembanked, so will also flood more frequently. And large part of the ports are also behind the barrier, so will also be affected by more frequent closures. So here there are a number of options under study, upgrade or even a new barrier, a permanent dam, which I will show in a minute, or say keep a bit of the barrier and raise the dikes and levees in the heavily urban area around it. So this is, I would say, the next bottleneck after the Eastern Scheldt. Over the last years, a plan has been put forward by a number of retired engineers who designed the Delta Works, who said, okay, we think a next step for Rotterdam could be a permanent dam. Then the ships to the eastern part of the port of Rotterdam would need to go through large sluices. And we would need, because the River Rhine also flows in here from the back, we would need mega pump stations to be able to pump out Rhine water in normal conditions, But we also have to think, if sea level rises, much more about the coincidence of high water levels on the coast and high river discharges. And well, that can also have, apart from hindrance to shipping and so on, could also have some benefits. There, for example, there will be less salt intrusions. And the more you control the water levels behind the barrier, let's say, the more suitable these areas will become for housing development. And that's also a reason why the other city, which has dam in its name, Amsterdam, is so nice. It's because the water level is fully controlled in the city by all kinds of gates and barriers. And that leaves a lot of room for nice houseboats and development on the waterfront. And because of the rivalry between Rotterdam and Amsterdam, usually the people in Rotterdam don't like it when we say they could, in this option, could become to look a bit more like Amsterdam. But this is one of the solutions that's currently being studied. And we also have a lot of master students who look at aspects like the dam design, the pump design, and so on. And then the coastal strategy, the current, let's say, strategy for this Holland coast, so we're gradually going to the north, is to maintain the coastline or the coastal volume by means of nourishment, about 16 million cubic yards per year. That volume will increase with the sea level rise rate. So the faster the sea level rise, the higher these volumes will become. So in case of 1 meter, 3 feet sea level rise in 100 years, so that's factor 5, let's say, faster sea level rise than we currently have, that would increase to by a factor 5 around, and so on. Well, also the type of nourishment has to be considered. So will it be gradually distributed along the coast or done with mega nourishments, such as this so-called sand motor? Is there sufficient sand? What are the environmental effects and emissions associated with all the large-scale dredging? Our colleagues from coastal engineering also looked at these type of questions. We are in the lucky position that this North Sea that the Netherlands is located at is this really giant box of sand. Already in the Dutch territory, if you take out the wind farms, defense areas, there's still enormous amounts of sand available, which will be sufficient for at least the coming century or coming centuries, even in higher sea level rise rate. So this, we expect that both in terms of costs, because the costs are about $5 million per million, or $5 per cubic yard. So the costs are relatively low, and in terms of supply, it's possible. And also ideas are under development to link wind energy to large-scale dredging. But of course, if you go to this really large-scale dredging, you also have to consider the environmental effects on the underwater life. Well, in the north there and the southwest, there are also, let's say, the sea dikes, the more conventional sea dikes, partially grass, partially revetments. Well, these can also be upgraded. So if sea level rises, you need to raise the defense, often more than the sea level rise, to account for additional wave attack. Then also widen the base if you keep the same profile. And in previous studies, we have looked at implications at the national scale, and that in the even if we go to high sea level rise values of 2 meters, 6 feet in coming 100 years, if you would incorporate that in all the hard defenses at upgrades of the storm surge barriers, it would be a major investment, around in the order of magnitude of 100 billion euros. But if you then distribute it over 100 years, it's, let's say, 1 billion euro, so that's $1.2 billion per year, which is basically a doubling of the current investment budget. And we feel that in the context of the national GDP, which is in the order of $800 billion, that's still affordable. But of course, if we raise those defenses, that will also have major implications, or widen those defenses, on the surrounding functions, especially in urban areas. So here the concept of multifunctional solutions is being explored and already implemented in some of the towns in Katwijk and Noordwijk. The sea defense has been strengthened, combined in this case, I believe it's Katwijk, with a parking garage. So these concepts are also being implemented. And also where possible, the concepts of nature-based solutions are being explored and also implemented. And here's a schematic graph that shows on the horizontal axis the footprint that you would need for a certain measure, and on the vertical axis the wave energy that you could potentially stop is added to the storm surge. And of course, the measure with the smallest footprint is the flood wall, like implemented here in New Orleans, but it's generally seen as less attractive. Sea dikes already get a bit of a wider footprint. And if we go to these nature-based solutions, we also see that wetlands, like at really large scales, like in New Orleans, can contribute to wave and surge reduction. But nowadays in the Netherlands, particularly these type of, we call them hybrid solutions, so combinations of dikes and foreshores are being implemented where there's sufficient space, because usually they need at least hundreds of meters of space on the front. One example is the in North Holland, it's called Hondsbosse Zeewering, where on the small panel you see the old sea defense, which was one of the few remaining hard sea defenses. And here you see the new situation where basically a whole new dune landscape has been implemented in front, basically burying this old hard sea dike. And also in the north, in the Wadden area, at some places, instead of raising the green dike, it's being investigated and nowadays implemented that here the foreshores can be extended. That would reduce the wave attack, reduce wave run-up, just so reducing or either even fully eliminating the need for upgrading this defense. And there are several examples, again, where there is space, this seems to become a preferred solution. So we think, at least on the, let's say, preliminary investigations, that adapting the system with the conventional measures for at least 1-2 meters of sea level rise is possible, but we also have to think beyond that at the longer term future, and also look at the more let's say drastic strategies, what could happen in case of very high sea level rise values. Here's some images by Deltares that indicate a bit in a cartoon style the approaches. So a fully fortified system with giant pumps, a bit like the proposal for Rotterdam, an open system where the rivers are kept open but rise with the sea level, and then the levees are built around it, seaward expansion where new high and dry areas are being constructed, or the images that I started with, which I would call accommodate, so retreat in many areas, but also build or keep a number of floating islands. And the interesting thing is that the current strategy in the Netherlands in different areas is a bit of a mix. In the north, IJsselmeer, Lake IJssel, Closure Dam, Afsluitdijk, it's a dam where now pumps are being implemented. Parts of the system are partially open in the southwest. Nieuwpoort of Rotterdam has been built Maasvlakte as a seaward expansion. So maybe these are not national strategies where you pick one, but you can also differentiate regionally. Well, if things really get out of hand, you could also take an even more zoom out and take a European approach. And this is a plan put forward, luckily not by a civil engineer, because he or she would immediately blamed for these type of plans, but by someone from the Oceanography Institute, Sjoerd Groeskamp, where he said, well, instead of adapting the entire coastline of northwestern Europe, so all around the North Sea and the Baltic, one alternative option could be to build giant dams, which he calls the NEET, the Northern European Enclosure Dam. And he has, they estimate that the cost would go up to $500 billion. And of course, these would be giant engineering plans. The largest dams in the world are now around 30 kilometers in Korea and the Afsluitdijk Closure Dam in the Netherlands. So these are a factor 10, 20 longer. And the water is also much deeper here in this part of the North Sea, depths up to 60 meters. And right now, with students, we are looking at various aspects of the dams, like the impacts on water quality, the engineering, seismic vulnerability, and so on. But as Groskamp always says, I hope we don't need it. And if we need it, we have failed. But we do need to study this option in case we need it. So to recap, a small recap on the adaptation strategies as I see them or as I saw them. The current system is, we expect, well capable of handling about 0.5 to 1 meter of sea level rise, because that's already incorporated in most of the designs. The first bottlenecks will occur at these barriers, the Maasland barrier and particularly the Eastern Scheldt. After that, then you have to look at drastic adaptations of these barriers, new barriers, dam alternatives, and so on, because that takes a lot of time for planning. It's good to start thinking about it now. Both the dike reinforcements and the nourishments are quite economically and technically quite well scalable for several meters. So up to 10 feet of sea level rise is the current expectation. And we expect that these drastic plans of retreat damming the North Sea will be beyond 5 meters, 15 feet, but we haven't studied the exact say tipping points when we would need these. Well, that was, then there's also the question, can we build it and can we afford it? And then it's good to look a bit back at two other, let's say, mega engineering projects, the COST, the Delta Plan and the New Orleans Hurricane Protection System. The Dutch Delta Plan in present terms is about 12 billion euros, what we estimate, $15 billion. Took a few decades for all the different dams to build. New Orleans system was built at incredible speed. It's really impressive, around 7 years from Katrina to completion. So that's really an amazing accomplishment, also at a similar cost. And we think that the cost of the future Delta Plan adapting to 1 to 2 meter sea level rise will go up from 50 to 100 billion euro. And depending on the sea level rise rate, that has to be done in a number of decades or in a century. So if you then divide the cost to an annual cost and compare it with these projects, we think it is possible. Of course, it depends on the political decision-making and other factors. Well, that was the story until about a few months ago, and then our Met Office, the KNMI, published a new graph, and they said, this graph, the vertical axis shows sea level rise in meters, so again, multiply by 3, and in green and pink type of color, you see the scenarios that I just highlighted. But they said, well, there is another high-end worst-case extreme scenario that could, if a lot of climate developments come together, that could happen. But on the other hand, they indicate it's a very low likelihood. So this is really a very small probability scenario, if I understand them correctly. But you can then debate if you should show it in the same shading, but that's another debate. But of course, if this would happen, and if we would see massive melting of Antarctica and so on, that would drastically change that story and that picture, because then already within one century, we could have up to 5 meter and so on. So also the speed of the sea level rise is then much faster. So this is definitely a let's say, something to consider what happens here. But if that happens, you would also see all the signals in the Antarctica and so on. So that would also give trigger warnings there. So that is about the Netherlands. Still a lot of work to do to study on those type of questions and also this new scenario. But of course, the issue of adaptation is not limited to the Netherlands. There are many countries with much longer coastlines like your country. And sometimes we have the chance to be involved in some of the research and advisory activities. One area that we've worked on over the past 10 years, also with the help of a lot of students, is the Houston-Galveston area in Texas. And if you flip the Netherlands, it may look a bit similar to this, our IJsselmeer, Lake IJssel, with the Afsluitdijk closure dam in terms of size. It's a bit similar to Galveston Bay. Here we have Amsterdam, and in the US you have Houston. But of course, there are also differences. Well, we've also with partners at Texas A&M Galveston, and a lot of help of students, we've looked at options for the coastal defense system, and particularly here, this inlet to the Galveston Bay and the Port of Houston, where we've worked on storm surge barrier concepts. A few years ago, it even caught the eye of the president at that time of the United States, we think, because it was featured on Fox News, so that may have had a positive impact on the decision making. And I know at this point, U.S. Army Corps is taking, together with state partners, taking that plan really further into engineering and conceptual design. And here are some of the topics that people from our team and students also have worked on. The ideas for the storm surge barrier. So that's the 3 kilometer, 2 mile wide inlet to the Galveston Bay, where you want to facilitate shipping, so similar to the Maasland barrier, and at the same time facilitate in and outflow as much as you can to preserve the environment. So we've studied barrier concepts like the this for the environmental section, something a bit similar to the Eastern Scheld. For navigation section, ideas have been put forward are the barge gate that we have studied, or the Army Corps studied a sector gate more similar to the Maasland barrier. We've also looked a bit at innovative concepts. So one of our students has designed inflatable barriers where already at a smaller scale, one has been built in the Netherlands. So this has been, let's say, very interesting for us also to contribute to those discussions, also on the more nature-based strengthening like a dune system that would be able to withstand this 100-year conditions, what would it look like? So I think it's great to be able to jointly work and partner on those types of studies and investigations, because the characteristic of these type of adaptation coastal protection schemes is that they are not taken from the shelf, but are unique challenges. And of course, where I'm hopeful and very positive that we can adapt in the Netherlands, the issues in other parts of the world are much more urgent and problematic, where already very regular flooding is experienced in, for example, parts of Indonesia. People in Bangladesh live on the open exposed coast, but also here we have done some work together with the World Bank on scaling up the adaptation of the coastal system, both by means of coastal dikes, levees, but also nature-based solutions. So there's really a lot to do, and where we can contribute, we try. As a final slide, adaptation to sea level rise. I think in the Netherlands, it's definitely feasible and possible for the ranges of sea level rise projected in the coming centuries. It will be a major effort, but solutions are available and I think also affordable if you look in the context of the national economy. As planning for these type of interventions needs decades without a disaster, particularly for an area like Rotterdam, if you change the barrier, change the port and so on. It's very good to start now in planning and engineering. In this talk, I've only focused on sea level rise, but of course, we have many other climate hydraulic related issues. For example, in the south of the Netherlands, Belgium, and Germany, there were major, major floods last summer with enormous impacts in terms of damage and also fatalities in our neighboring countries. So these also need a lot of attention. And I think in the National Adaptation Program, and we are a bit involved, there's next steps are the conceptual design of those type of strategies and interventions. Thinking about other transitions, the transition in energy, urban areas, and so on. And that also in terms of education requires really a multidisciplinary work of civil engineers, architects, ecologists, governance experts. So in our university context, we try to put them together in this Delta Futures Lab. Well, basically to end, this is not, these are international issues that we all face, adaptation to sea level rise or coastal protection, coastal flood risk reduction. So it's great if we can collaborate on these. So here are a number of people that have been involved in the thinking development discussion. So I'm not going to mention them all, but you can see them here. And with that, I would like to end and thank you for your attention.
Bas, thank you very much for this intriguing and educational talk. I think we've all been able to learn a lot about the issues faced and ways to deal with the hazard you face in what's one of the most vulnerable countries in the world and what we could learn about that for our own situation. So based on your talk, I want to transition now to the panel discussion. Again, on our panel, we have Jane Smith from the Army Corps of Engineers, Louis Armstrong from Kleinfelder, and Oki Nogu from Omega Hydrodynamics, previously U of M. And we had a set of questions that were submitted by participants previous to the session. So we're going to start touching on those first. And if we have time, we'll address what is currently in the Q&A. So I want to start with a question that was phrased as, to adapt levees for sea level rise, do you prefer a long view with lots of uncertainty or a shorter one that is revisited often? And I'm gonna ask Jane to begin the discussion on this, after which the other panelists and Bas should also give their ideas.
Thanks, Jeremy, and thanks, Bas, for a great talk. So the answer to that is both. We need to take a long view, but we also need to be aware of the uncertainty will be very high. And the high uncertainty will tend to lead us to over-design. So the best approach is typically to develop a phased design that's adaptive over time to sea level rise. If we consider levees, they're relatively easy to modify over time, assuming that we've already purchased the real estate to widen and raise the levees. So the levees can be raised over time as needed based on the observed hydrodynamic conditions, the sea level rise. And we also have the issue if the levees are overbuilt initially, that the weight of the levee will increase subsidence. Other structure types can also be adapted over time. So the foundation can be built in such a way that you can raise the structure itself for sea level rise. And a nice example of that is the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers New York District developed adaptable designs in some of the post-sandy projects on Staten Island. The large gates, like Bas talked about, are much more difficult to adapt incrementally. And Bas also mentioned natural nature-based features like dunes and reefs and wetlands, and they inherently depend on adaptation over time to provide risk reduction. That's a significant advantage, but it's also an area of ongoing R&D. And I'll end with two caveats. First of all, to adapt, we have to monitor and adjust over time, so we have to have the political and social will to do those things. And second, for many sites, we also need to have a pathway to retreat. In the US, we can't protect every mile of shoreline forever. So we need to make sure that we don't encourage greater development in some of these areas that can't be protected in the long term, because that will ultimately increase the risk. So it's important to think and plan long-term, but to act incrementally and adaptively, especially where the uncertainty is high. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Jane. Bas, do you want to comment on this?
I would comment fully in line with Jane's answer. The different interventions have different typical lifetimes. So nourishment, for 5 years, for the less adaptable storm surge barriers, at least certainly the less adaptable parts, you designed for a century. And we're now also working with the policy analysis to operationalize these concepts of adaptive planning, adaptive pathways to engineering structures. So that's also a bit of a new area, but fully agree with the line of thought of Jane.
Thank you very much. Lou and Oki, do you have anything to say about this question, or let me know if we should move on to the next one?
Jane really nailed it. It's really, that's exactly the way we need to think about these things.
Okay, so another very important question that was asked, I'm going to address this one to Lou initially, is what should be the role of engineers in rebuilding environments to brace for climate change?
Well, I think the role of engineers, we have to really think about, when we think about the solution, we see these final solutions, but it's a pathway to get there. You know, it starts with vulnerability assessments and identification of priorities. As Bas noted, it's not inexpensive to do some of this. So we have to identify those vulnerabilities. And you know, we think about the coast, we think about rivers and floods, but we also in some places need to think about groundwater levels and seawater intrusion into groundwater, which could impact foundations in seismic areas where there's piles. So again, lots of different assessments of the priorities and the vulnerabilities. We then need to go to environmental and social impact studies, and that engineers have a role in that. Jane mentioned the social will. We have to make sure people understand what we're doing and the impact to them and the environment. We then move into design. That's where people tend to think of the engineers, but there's the geotechnical, there's the structural. And I will say, you know, Kleinfelder's involved in a lot of these type things. For example, the vulnerability assessments, we're doing that in North Carolina with the Office of Recovery and Resilience, working with the Army Corps in Sacramento and San Joaquin in California on geotechnical and design type things. So, and then after the design, when you move to construction, these are, you know, critical infrastructure. So we need to think about, you know, construction engineers, quality assurance, quality control, materials testing, all the things that go with that, such that if you do have to do adaptive design, as Jane was talking about, you understand what you've built, what was the foundation, what was the materials that were used, so that you can adapt, and you want to make sure that this critical infrastructure is built properly so it can last a long time. So really, engineers from the thought to the construction need to be involved in this process.
Before we move on to another panelist or question on this one, there's a very related question, which Lou, I think you can give a good answer to, I think submitted by a student. Climate adaptation, especially if it's ecologically focused, is a narrow field, but I want to work in this field. How and where do I start?
Well, I think really the big thing about it is when you think about your passion, how you get into this, these are multidisciplinary things, and to start talking to people like engineers. I have a degree in oceanography as well as in engineering. So when Bas was making fun of the oceanographers there, I can get both sides of it. But I mean, it's important to talk to all the different people, biologists, wetland scientists, engineers, oceanographers, because these solutions will be multidisciplinary. And if you want to get into those ecological solutions, it's important to understand all the different aspects of it, you know, from the salt harvest mouse, which is a seawater drinking mouse or brackish water drinking mouse in California, which is a protected species. How does environmental adaptation impact that species, all the way through, you know, at the end of the day, protecting our cities and our built infrastructure. So really get that broad view.
Thank you, Lou. So on the role of engineers and opportunities in this field, Jane, Oki, and Bas, do you want to say anything about these? Just speak up if you do.
So I would double what Lou said about the need for interdisciplinary study, being able to work with other folks, you know, just communicating between disciplines is really hard. So there's a lot of opportunity right now. A lot of university programs are going much more interdisciplinary. So I think there's lots of opportunities to do that. I highly encourage it. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane. Thank you, Lou. So I will change the topic of the questions a little bit and address this question to Oki initially. Would sea level rise have a significant implication on sediment transport? And then what can we do about it?
Yeah, thank you, Jeremy, for the question. It's one of those interesting things where it's kind of obvious that with the rise in sea level, you would expect some correlation with sediment transport processes. So the obvious example would be if you look at a coastal dune, and you get a rise in the water level, then you have, you know, wave action at the raised elevation. And so you would expect, you know, incremental sediment transport processes. Now, Brune and others have kind of looked at this and come up with a kind of a simple formula in terms of how the shoreline retreats in terms of the shore face slope and all of that. And so, yes, it's, you know, there are simple type approaches to do it. But we know that that's for like a cross shore type thing where the beach kind of readjusts to the equilibrium profile. So it's a little bit more complex than that because those simple things do not take into account your sediment supply sources. So depending on what's going around, I mean, you have longshore sediment transport and all of that. So I would say that it's also good to remember that, you know, when we're talking about sea level rise, it's, you're looking at maybe a fraction of an inch per year. And it is the beaches and all the coastal areas will continuously adjust over time. So you're not going to put in a 1 meter rise in the water level and, you know, expect what's going to happen to the beach. So at least in my opinion, I think it's also critical to look at, you know, the impact of global climate change on the frequency of storms and their magnitude, because, I mean, those have a more destructive effect. So you're able to change the beach and coastlines in a matter of days, as opposed to the slow one where there are a lot of intervening factors which could kind of modify transport process. But it's really, sediment transport is really a fairly complex one. And I think Jane and others from the Corps of Engineers can probably chime in a little bit more. Thank you, Jeremy.
That's a great answer, Noki. And the only thing I would add is if we look at storm track changes, that will certainly impact the sediment transport patterns in different areas too. Boss brought up some interesting comments about sediment supply. If we're going to use natural nature-based features, whether it's to build wetlands or to build beaches, we need much larger sediment supply. And the Dutch are fairly lucky to have a large supply. There's not all the areas in the UK.
Okay, Jane, thank you very much. There's also a very related question to this on the list. And that is, what are challenges and opportunities for beneficially using sediment? Such as dredged sediment, I think, is what this participant is interested in. Maybe Boss or Jane, you might have something to say about this.
Boss, you want to go first?
Yeah, in the Netherlands, for example, in the riverine area, there's on the one side the Room for River project where you dredge the material. And they're now investigating whether it's possible to accept a bit of to use that material in your levee reinforcement, but then at the same time accept a little bit less geotechnical quality, because you don't have the perfect clay that you would want, but it's local, so it's cheaper, more environmentally friendly. So those type of developments. There's also experiments in the north in the Wadden. It's called not the sand motor, but the mud motor, to see if it's the dredged mud from the shipping lane, so to say, is used to strengthen the coast and see how it evolves. So there's definitely a lot of attention for those type of concepts. And there are possibilities.
Thank you.
So in the US, there's a lot of research looking at how we use dredge materials to nourish wetlands. I think Bas mentioned thin layer placement of dredge material. So how do we get the material in the right place, the right material? There's also been a lot of work on nearshore placement. Instead of placing sediments directly on the beach for beaches and dunes, can we place it in the nearshore where natural processes help sift out the fines and allow the sand to move onto the beach? So there's a lot of ongoing research in this area. Thanks.
You know, one thing I'll add in that, Jeremy, is it's also important to think about the fact that we're seeing larger storms and more upland flooding. So now we're getting more erosion, more sediment into the system. So typical dredge cycles may need to change. And also some of the types of materials are changing. So again, we have a dynamic system of saying now we've got more sediment load and perhaps different sediment types coming into the system. So it's back to making sure we're testing those sediments and thinking about it the way that that Bas and Jane discussed.
Thank you. That's a good point, Lou, whether the sediment is sand, which is more easily reused in construction, versus silt or clay, which might not keep its cohesive properties well established if it's dredged. Another set of questions which would be good to address now is about planning. So one of the questions a participant asked is, how are the Dutch dealing with land development rights versus planned retreat from high-risk areas? And we can also complement with that with how can Americans deal with land development rights versus hope-for retreat? Do I have a volunteer to try to address this at the beginning? Bas, for land development rights in the Netherlands, you were the one who can hopefully answer this.
I'm still thinking about the question. How would land development from high-risk areas? Jeremy,
I think,
you know the Dutch context very well. So
I think what he means is if a company owns a development in an area that is high-risk and we want to retreat from there and close the residences and shops and relocate them all. What happens to the right of the owner to that land? Do they have the right for that land in the first place, or is that land owned by the government and they just lease it? Or do they own that land and they have to be bought out, or they have to be given land elsewhere in return for that?
Yeah, so in Netherlands, maybe most comparable is we call unembanked areas, so people living outside of the levees in flood-prone areas. In there are like factories or local houses where it's their land. Of course, they can choose to locally adapt. If they then decide to move out for their own, based on their own choice, of course, that's their own choice. But if there's some large-scale government a program like Room for Rivers or something, sometimes they are being bought out.
I guess an example of a related issue is the Hedwig polder, which is a polder on the border of Holland and Belgium, or Zeeland and Belgium, which was bought by the government in order to restore it to intertidal land as mitigation for dredging the Port of Rotterdam. And the owner of that land was very hesitant to sell, even though he would be paid for it, because that land was fought hard for to reclaim from the sea. To let the sea reclaim it again was difficult culturally. What about in the case of the US, Jane or Lou, do you have any idea how relocation can be accomplished practically if there are land ownership rights at stake?
Well, I would start out by saying that the states and most times are doing the zoning. And so it's a state issue in terms of what you can do for protection. So we know some states like North Carolina don't allow structures. And so, you know, if your house is damaged, you may not be able to rebuild and are forced then to relocate. Within coastal projects, there are times where we buy out land. We think of it maybe more in a flooding inland flooding case where there's buyouts, but there have also been in studies like post-Katrina on the Mississippi coast, there were a number of areas that were bought out and changed to open land from there. So there are lots of mechanisms to do it. I don't think there's maybe a perfect model that everybody's following at this point, and maybe more standardized it would be helpful.
Thank you, Bas, and thank you, Jane. Lou or Oki, do you have anything to say on this question? Okay, so a related question that was also asked is, wouldn't it be better to invest in moving to higher ground? Who wants to respond to that?
Well, I guess it depends on how much higher ground you have. I think in the case of the Netherlands, ground runs out fairly quickly when you start talking about higher ground. I think it's always hard to do this. And again, we're talking about sea level rise here, but we have other climatic changes that we're addressing. And I do think, when I talk about these vulnerability assessments, a lot of times they're inland. I mean, if you think about where Sacramento and Stockton are relative to the sea, they're quite inland, but they're still impacted by sea level rise as it backs the water up in the major rivers. So, I think there's always that the solutions. I do think what Bas showed though is these hybrid solutions as well as these multi-use solutions. I think that's a really important factor to think about as well. Moving parking lots to, integrated into levees or other things. It also helps with the previous question in terms of land rights if you create another beneficial use from a protective scenario. And it could even potentially generate revenue, maybe not in a large scale, but to somewhat offset some of these costs at a local level. If you can look at those hybrid type solutions where it impacts or benefits the environment, benefits the residents and the community, and then also protects the infrastructure, those are true win-win-win type solutions.
And Lou, that brings us right into our final question because we have only a minute or two left. Can you speak to the financing mechanisms in place to pay for adaptations? Oh, yeah, go ahead.
Well, I think there's lots of, obviously, I think the commitment, and it gets back to what Jane and Oki and Bas all said, there has to be this understanding. It's a complex system, and there has to be kind of a social buy-in. So a lot of this is going to come from either local, state, or federal governments. But I do think when you start to involve the business community into thinking about this and create these kind of beneficial uses, then you get more buy-in, and there could be other sources of funding that would be out there, be it public-private partnerships or things of that nature.
Thank you very much.